Good morning, St. James Church. Hello, everyone.
Good morning.
I'm Dave McCure here. Two of my daughters on stage as well. And we have Fabian as well this morning.
Yes.
And we're going to do an all-age song in a minute. But before we do that, we just want to welcome you. Thank you for coming out and being with us this Sunday morning. We are going to ask you a question I want you to think about until after the first song. So we want to know what you thought of the prayer month or how you interacted with it. And then we'll ask you a few questions. So whether you interacted with the material through the home groups or you came to the prayer room or the campfire prayers or anything that you loved, that you'd like to see us do again, please let us know after the first song. Do you want to do the gathering?
And if you can respond with the words in yellow. So it's asking God's Spirit to come, fill us afresh and lead us in this service. Rushing wind of the Spirit, breathe new life into us. Blazing flame of the Spirit, burn away our fears. Comforting presence of the Spirit, heal our wounds. Let's worship and praise you, Holy God. Spirit of God, come upon us this day and fill us with your love. Make us people to proclaim God's news in all that we do. So we're going to have, can I show some of those action? Because you can't hear. So it's, he is the light of the world. And when you hear that, it says he is the light, 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 light of the world. And that's, we do that, I think, 3 or 4 times. And he shines, shines, shines all over the world, shining bright, bright, bright. He is the light of the world. So that's the action. So are you going to help me?
Any of the children would like to come and join us on stage with the hands finishing, so there is a camera.
Yeah.
So if you'd like to come up, then you're more than welcome.
Take with you a flag, that would be great.
Well done, Megan. So we are going to go out to Children's Church now. It's a very special one because it's the last one of the academic year before we start our all-age services for the summer. So we have loads of games, party food, songs and things to do. So if there's any new children here or anyone of any age actually who's I'll be up for that. Come and join us.
You won't have anybody for church favours.
Please be seated. So yes, so we're coming to the end of our month of prayer, but we feel it's not the end. Of course, it's not the end of prayer. And one of the things that we've decided is we're going to keep that room, and it's going to stay there. It's going to be transformed through the seasons, through the year. And it's going to be, I believe, a really special place for people to come, to be quiet, to be restful. And one of the story is there's been some people from the community who have used that room quite regularly. And when Vashti and Wendy and Johan came to change, as we will see, it's a little bit different, the person was there. And she shared a little bit of her life, and they were able to pray with her. And that's the kind of story of this month of prayer. So I wonder whether you have those kind of experiences or story. Maybe you were more engaged with prayer in your life group, your home group. Maybe you did some kind of prayer walk, or you were maybe a bit more aware of praying through the day. Maybe you engage with some of those services. We had the room, we have a service, we had a service outside. So if you want to share, this is the opportunity to share and to encourage us. Has it made some kind, not difference, but has it warmed your heart towards prayer, towards talking to God, and towards seeing His Him at work in your life? So who might be courageous enough to say something? Yes, okay, Andy, I'll get the microphone to you. You can stay there, and then, I'll go around.
Yeah, I think the whole experience this last month has just shown me how important prayer is, and the prayer walk was brilliant, and the discussions in home group were excellent as well, and that prayer space as well. Just go into that prayer space and open the Bible and find a verse that speaks to you. That happened to me, and I thought it was really good. So well done.
Ooh. Okay, one more.
Hello, this might not relate to this particular prayer thing, but I'd just like to share something that I've been doing for about 1.5 decades, and that is emailing a friend with all sorts of stuff that comes through my inbox about all kinds of problems that I can't solve myself, and I don't think they can either, but we can, between us, pray for them. We may be the only ones doing it. Mm. Maybe not for any longer, though.
Oh, what a good idea, yeah. Having some prayer partner is so important, that you find a place where, you know, life groups, home groups, yes, but sometimes you just want smaller groups, 2 or 3, and having dedicated prayer partners who you can share prayer requests and see God at work, yes. Now, I know that yes, Martin, thank you.
I'd just like to say the prayer walking changes our focus from what happens in the building. So all the people outside, those 7,000 people that we aren't reaching. So let's continue the prayer walking and make that a regular part of our church life.
Mm, yeah. And let's become more aware. We always walk around every day, and to make it a prayerful activity, in a sense of being open to what God might be doing. I would love to have feedbacks too. It hasn't been perfect. Maybe the way we've communicated, maybe there was other things we could have thought about. But I already think that it could become an annual reality, just to warm up our prayer life once a year, have a more dedicated 30 days of prayer, but also to keep us kind of abreast with prayer, and we'll hear something, an initiative that we'll have in September. So thank you very much for those feedbacks, and do send me an email if you have some ideas or some feedbacks about your own experience. Let's move to the time when we come to God, and our confession is a prayer, is talking to God, using sometimes liturgy that helps us put words in what we feel. And we just then are in God's presence to receive His grace, His forgiveness, and His strength. So there will be words on the screen, and again, those in yellow is for you to respond with. The Spirit of the Lord fills the world, and knows our every word and deed. Let us then open ourselves to the Lord and seek his forgiveness in repentance and faith. Forgive us when we live as if you're not real, pushing you aside to play God in your world. Lord, have mercy. Forgive our impatience when we plunge ahead rather than wait for you. Lord, have mercy. Forgive our ignorance when we think we have a better way than what you show us in your word. Lord, have mercy. Forgive our words used to hurt others rather than encourage them. Lord, have mercy. Forgive us for loving things too much, people and you too little. Lord, have mercy. Father Almighty, we believe that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Through his merits, we receive your forgiveness. Give us eyes to see you on the move, active, alive in our world every day. Give us ears to hear the whisper of your Spirit, recalling your word and guiding our steps. And give us will that are responsive to your will, hands quick to serve, feet swift to go where there is a need. Amen. So we move into our time when we sing, we praise, we, if singing is not your thing, we just remain in God's presence, hearing each other and using music and songs to bring about our gratitude and our praise and our thanks. So someone's going to introduce that for us today. Thank you very much.
In the readings in the sermon after the praise time, we're going to be thinking about who to listen to. And when it comes to all the different voices speaking to us in our lives that we could listen to, we're spoilt for choice. And our first two songs remind us of why God actually deserves to be number one on the list of people that we listen to. We're going to sing "Thank You for Saving Me" and "Lord, I Lift Your Name on High." And we're going to praise God for who he is and what he's done for us. Our third song is "From the Breaking of the Dawn," with its repeated refrain, "I will stand on every promise of your word." And as we sing this, we're doing a number of things. We're renewing our commitment to trust and follow God, and we're affirming his goodness and faithfulness to us. But the song also, in a sense, encourages us to preach to ourselves and remind ourselves of why we know we can make that commitment, even when times are tough and we're fallible. And as I was thinking about what to say about the songs this morning, I was reminded of a couple of verses in 1 Thessalonians 5. "May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it." So let's praise and worship God for everything he has done and everything he will do.
You shed your Thank you.
seated. And let's just maybe take a moment of quietness as we let, particularly that last song, Standing on Every Promise of God's Word. I wonder what that promise means to you this morning. Promise of encouragement that the one who has started this good work in you is able and will accomplish it. A promise of strength to leave behind a bad habit and live in the freedom of Christ. A promise maybe about your service, hearing a fresh, good and faithful servant. The promise that we are, as sons and daughters of the living God, beloved, saved by grace, sealed with his very presence, the Holy Spirit. So, Father, this morning, all together, we proclaim again our gratitude for all the promises that are in your word. And in trust, we look for their becoming true in our lives, in our families, in our communities, in this land and in our world. We ask that in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. So we're going to have our two readings, one from the New Testament, Gospel of Matthew, and then one from 2 Timothy. So if you can ask Jenny to come first, and then Nigel will come to read the next one.
The first reading is from Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 to 20, continuing Jesus' words from the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew 7, starting at verse 13. The narrow and wide gates. Enter now through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. By their fruit you will recognize them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by their fruit, you will recognize them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our second reading is taken from the second book of Timothy, chapter 4, verses 4 to 8. And this is in the section, A Final Charge to Timothy. And Paul notes in this one that his time is coming to closing. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather round them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. But you, keep your head in all situations, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, discharge all your duties of your ministry. For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's just pray. Jesus, open our ears to hear your voice, our heart to receive you, and our wills to put in practice your way of life. Amen. So we're coming to the end of our series, Sermon on the Mount. There's still a few verses after that, but we won't be able to cover that because we are moving into a new series with our summer holiday. And so it's going to be a close now. It's a little bit early, but I think at some other points in the last year we've kind of explored especially this text that ends the Sermon on the Mount, which is about the two houses, the one that is built on the rock and one that is built on the sand. But I think this passage is just about that. Who do we listen to and who do we follow? Which voices are we going to follow through our lives? So we just heard there are many voices in our world. Maybe we are in a society when we can hear things that would be unthinkable before. One of the way we can hear a lot of things is through the radio. So I wonder what kind of radio listener you are. So let's do a little test. If you are, I know it's like a mixture, it's like how you feel, but mainly if you really like Radio 4. Who likes Radio 4? I do like Radio 4. Yeah, we have quite a few Radio 4 people. Then we have Classic FM. Yeah, who likes Classic FM? I like Classic FM when I'm in the car. So I'm the Classic FM. My wife is the Hard FM. So who's the Hard FM? You know, not many. Oh yeah, we have a few. We have a few Hearts. There we go. Now, if you have to choose between Radio 1, 2, and 3, who would be 1? I would be more 1. Who would be 2? And who would be Radio 3? There we go. That's it. Yeah. If you had to choose between Tone FM and Apple FM, who would be Tone FM? I think that would be more. Who would be Apple FM? You have no idea what Apple FM is. It is okay. There you go. Probably we listen to kind of a variety, but it would say something of who you are, what you like, who you listen to. What about this one? You most probably know that expression that if you want to know someone, look at their bookshelves. Yeah. Now that becomes more and more difficult because more and more of our bookshelves are kind of virtual. You know, they might be on your iPad, on your, so it might be difficult to recognize. But again, you know, are you a fiction person or a non-fiction? Do you like detective novel, crime novel, romantic novel, or are you into poetry? Do you read to relax in general, or do you read to learn? Do you have an interest in history, politics, social science, psychology, philosophy, and may I say, maybe theology? It will tell something about who we are and also something about who we listen to. And it's good to listen to different voices and to, you know, reflect and think, but there is one voice that should always be above all the others, and that's the voice of Jesus. And I think that's where Jesus is coming at here in our reading. We have this well-known passage of entering through a gate, and it says one is narrow and one is wide. The one that is narrow has a hard road, and the one that's wide has an easy road. The one leads to life, and the one leads to destruction. The first one, not many are willing to take it. The second one, many are happy to take it. So what is Jesus here talking about? Is he interested in actually telling us, you know, only a few will be saved? I don't think so. He's not saying, you know, will be 5% saved, 95% unsaved, 10% or 20. Actually, looking at the context again, and looking also at the verbs and the tense, Jesus is interested to grab the attention of his readers and his listeners at the time. And the listeners at the time were the Jews. And it would have been strange for them to hear that a few will find a narrow door, and that the majority goes through a wide door. They all thought, we're part of the covenant. For sure, God is on our side. So the context when Jesus speaks is about, I'm talking to you, and I want you to enter the narrow gate. I want you to have life. That's his purpose, in a sense of shocking. He wants everybody to find life. But he says, it's going to be a narrow gate. The Greek word for broad is spacious and roomy. The Greek word for the narrow is kind of confined. So, enter through the narrow gate. If you look a little bit just after that chapter, you have some stories of healings. And one of the first healing you get in chapter 8 is a Roman centurion, a non-Jew, an enemy. And he gets it. Jesus, he comes, he sends someone to Jesus, and because his daughter is sick, and he says, please, you know, heal my daughter. But he says, don't come to me, because I know the rules. You know, Jews don't mix with Gentiles. Just say the word, and I know my daughter will be safe. And Matthew puts that passage to just show those they thought would never enter the kingdom, a Roman, a Gentile, is the example of how do we enter the kingdom? By faith. By trusting oneself in the person of Jesus. And he was preparing the Jews to what was going to happen on the cross and the reality of the resurrection, that salvation was now to come through him, that he was going to be the way, the life, and the truth. So what is the narrow gate? What is he talking about? Well, it's narrow because it's only one option. It's one way. And it's a person. It's not a plan, it's not a philosophy, it's not do this and do that, and God will be impressed and will take you into his presence. No. It's a person and it's relational. And for a relation to work, it's every day. And in a sense, you know that, you know, those close relationships that we have, it's a delight, it's a joy, but it's hard work if we want to make it succeed. So maybe God, Jesus is saying something. The road is hard. It's not hard because it's so complicated, but because it's a commitment day after day after day to live out of a relationship with Jesus. Outside Jesus, there is no rescue. There is no life. There is no redemption. There is no hope. I believe when Jesus says the narrow gate, he was pointing to him. He is the narrow gate. He will say in John's Gospel, I tell you this truth, I am the gate. Whoever enters through me, I will rescue and I will care for. In another place, he says, I am the way. We could translate it with the road. I am the road, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. You might recognize that picture from a series called The Chosen. I do encourage you, you can download it as an app, you can see it, I think, on Netflix or Amazon, but it's a great series. But I liked when the picture was shown, I think, a few weeks ago. You remember that the passage just before is about knocking, seeking, and asking. And you knock at the door, and you enter into the presence. And that's the gate. We enter through the gate into the presence of Jesus. And I need to look at that eyes more often. Sometimes I feel Jesus more as someone who says, you know, it's not enough what you're doing. You have that feeling, you woke up in the morning, and you don't think it's not enough. Jesus says, I am with you, always. Now, our culture is a culture of pluralism, many ways. And so the suggestion that there's only one way to God is not very popular to our modern ear, but that's the claim that Jesus makes. There is no name in heaven or on earth by which one must be saved, only through Jesus. And we can't have a foot on one road and a foot on the other road. It's a hard road because it's a total commitment of all our lives, all that we are, all our resources. Now, it is a journey, and yesterday we had a service here with lay ministry, so that's all the ministry in the churches that are done by people like you. And the theme was journey. Yes, it's something we grow into, but the commitment must be total. A paraphrase from that narrow gate and broad gate is, don't look for shortcuts to God. The market is flooded with surefire, easygoing formulas for a successful life that can be practiced in your spare time. Don't fall for that stuff, even though crowds of people do. The way to life, the way to God, is vigorous and requires total and everyday turning to Jesus. That's the Christian life. And then Jesus moves into warnings about false prophets. And he says, be careful. False prophets are like a wolf in sheep clothes. Can you see the wolf there in the middle? It's just right at the middle, staring at you. It's very difficult to find, yeah. Beware of false prophets, you know them by what they do. Now, again, for a Jew, they were used to hear stories of false prophets. They had, in the Old Testament, lots of stories of prophets that were misguiding, misdirecting, misquoting the intentions of God. A prophet was someone who was the spokesmouth of God, helping the people, coming, returning, living the life that God wanted. And of course, in that time, was around the law, the Moses law. He says, be aware of them, but don't try to see what you can't see. We can't see motivations and the agenda. That's what's wrong with wrong prophets. We could extend it to teachers, to pastors, to vicars, any leaders who are there normally to help the people live the life that God intends them to live. It's about motivation and agenda. It's about what happens in my heart. You can't see that. God sees it. But there is something you can see, is the fruits. And that's what Jesus says. You're not there to try to find out the motivation, but you will recognize by their fruit. Good trees cannot produce bad fruit, nor can a bad tree produce good fruit. And so he goes on to, people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles. Good trees bear good fruits, bad trees bear bad fruit. Good trees cannot bear bad fruit, and bad trees cannot bear good fruit. I like Jesus, because if you don't get the first time, he said the second time, and then he repeated three times at least. I think that a good preacher should always repeat three times things at least. The message says, don't be impressed with charisma, look for character. Now, there is nothing wrong with charisma. It's good to have, you know, an energetic leader, and but that's not the main point. Look for character. And so looking at our second reading, I think Paul gives, definitely to Timothy, but to all of us, some characteristic of what a good leader, a good preacher, a good teacher should look like. So what are they? Well, he starts by saying that we will be judged by Jesus Christ. And I think any good teacher, any good pastors, any good vicar, any good leaders knows that. He is not talking on his own. He's bearer of a message that doesn't belong to him or to her. He's there to represent someone, Jesus, someone he will see or she will see. And so that person is intensely aware that he is the bearer of a message. He doesn't have the liberty to come up with his own interesting ideas, although we have some creativity, of course, but it should always direct to Jesus, to Christ. It should be Christ-centered. The message, the gate, is a person. And that's what happened in the book of Acts. And I'm just going to hear one of the story there, when Peter, and it shows what is the heart of a good leader. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, it says, said to them, "Ruler and leaders of the people," those are the Jews, "if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, there has been a healing taking place, then know this, you and all the people, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven and earth given to mankind by which we must be saved." I think one of the characteristics is humility. It's even if a person has a successful ministry, they will say, it is Jesus' power through me and in me. It is the work of the Holy Spirit. It's God's presence who transforms, who heals, who makes things flourish. And it happens when we are Christ-centered, when we preach the cross, where we find our forgiveness, and when we preach resurrection, bodily resurrection. Often I hear, you know, people rejoicing when we die, we'll be in God's presence and, you know, we won't have any pain. But that's not the end. What God has in mind is bodily resurrection. He will renew the whole creation and will give us new bodies. We will live with new bodies, like Jesus had a new body when he showed himself for 40 days. So Christ-centered. There we go. The second one is that they're also aware that they're working towards the coming of the kingdom. The kingdom has already come in Jesus. The reign of God is there. And they prepare the people to grow in that reality. Jesus died for you on your behalf. Humanity in this current state is unfit for God's future, for what he wants to do with recreation. It needs to go through a new birth. That's what John says. A birth from above. A birth from God's Holy Spirit. And it comes when we realize our condition and our need for grace, for mercy, for forgiveness. And we start that relationship then with God. It says here, preach. Preach the word. So a good leader, preach the word. But that word, preach, is keruzo, which means announce the coming of someone. A herald is someone who's announcing the coming of someone else. That's what a good vicar, a good pastor, a good teacher, he should continuously announce the coming of someone else, the coming of Jesus, who comes in our own life today, that's the coming of the kingdom now, but who will also come in the future. And so preach the word, and the word, we have the written word that leads to Jesus, the living word, and the living words become a words of power when it's done through the power of the Holy Spirit. And then finally, no, thirdly, there's four points. Sorry, there's 4 points. There should be three, but I have 4 points. The person who teaches, preaches, is not dependent on the reception. Now, I must tell as a vicar, that's hard. I would prefer, you know, to talk to you and you have big smiles and I feel good about myself then. It's hard when you have to say a message. That's hard. That's difficult. But look at the words that Paul used. He doesn't start with, you know, being all, you know, encouraging and kind. He starts with correct, rebuke, and encourage. Those are not easy words to say for a leader. Correct, rebuke. But it has to be with an attitude of love and of sensitivity. Correct is about redirecting. Teach your people to focus on Jesus. And it says here, how do we do it? How sure do we do it? With patience and careful instruction. Instructions, careful instructions lead people into the life that they are meant to live. And that happens in season when things go well, and that happens out of season when people are not so receptive. They might be opposed, they might criticize, they might resist, they might reject. Finally, point number four, someone who's clear-headed. He says here, the time is coming. Paul really felt, and he had his share of, you know, false teacher that he had to rebuke, and most of his letter was addressing, correcting, instructing. But he was seeing a time when it would even grow. People will come, wolf in clothed sheep. And they will gather around great numbers of teachers. Now, we don't know, in Timothy, it might be pointing to a movement called Gnosticism. I'm not going to say too much about it, but it looks like. And Gnosticism was about a secret kind of knowledge that you could discover, and only a few had this kind of spark in themselves. And it was all kind of very strange myth. But they would use scripture, they would try to refer them to Jesus. And some of it happens today with kind of hidden gospels and apocrypha and things like that. But basically, they're clear-headed, sound doctrine, healthy, proof and tested. And the idea of, what's the word here, itching ears, is this. Itching ears means having their ears tickled. So those teachers, they tickled your ears because you're not really interested in the depth, you know, you just want to amuse yourself. So merely scratched their eardrums without penetrating deeper. And I think that's why I'm exciting at this church. The first of the principle that guides our life is to be rooted, to be deeply rooted in prayer, in the Bible, the whole of Scripture, and the life of Jesus. You can find that in our website. It's a vision and our principles. Encountering God, growing as followers of Jesus, and participating in the life of the Spirit. And the first principle is that deeply rooted in prayer. I'm excited about the 30 days, the things we continue, but deeply rooted in prayer, in the Bible, and the life of Jesus. That's what we aspire. So to whom am I listening most? Well, as Christian, yes, it should be Jesus. It should be taking time in Scripture. It should be taking time in prayer with one another to encourage one another. And Paul then ends with, he is the one who fought the good fight, who listened the right voices, who kept the faith. He says, I fought the good fight, which for him was to proclaim Christ to the Gentiles, to plant communities that were Christ-centered, to instruct those communities, to live out their new identity as Christians. It was to be a servant of Christ, and the word servant is slave, doulos, to give us his whole life in service to the cause of Jesus. And he finished that race, and he kept the faith in Jesus. Now your fight will be different than mine. Your race will be different than mine. But that's the challenge. And it's not a fight and a race we do on our own strength, but day by day, with the help of Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, We will grow into those Christ-centered actions and purposes. So live out your identity of son and daughter with the energy that God gives you. Listen to Jesus. He is the narrow gate. Walk with him closely and engage with him. And we will be amazed what God will do in us, through us, individually, but more importantly, as a body. So let's pray. Jesus, we recognize you as the only way for us to find life, meaning, purpose, forgiveness. And if there is anyone today who still doubts whether they have you as their Lord and Savior, please speak to them and maybe give them the energy to go for prayer. Thank you, Jesus, that you are alive, and thank you for the gift of the Spirit. Lead us into your good future as a church, and protect us, Lord, from being us going astray. Help us to walk that road, that narrow road, which is a road to life, walking closer to you. We ask that in your name. Amen. So if I can ask James to come for the prayers. Thank you.
When I was preaching last week, I was preaching on the Ask, Seek, Knock passage, and one of the things I mentioned was things we can do to invigorate our prayer life, and one of the things I mentioned very briefly was praying scripture, and I'm going to do that this morning. I'm going to focus on three areas of prayer: giving thanks, asking for forgiveness, and prayers of petition, and just read a bit of from the book of Psalms for each of those. But the main point I was trying to make last week, and I think it's been through all of this Sermon on the Mount, is that first and foremost, it's about a relationship with Jesus when we're knocking on the door. As Fabian said again this week, it's the door's opened for us to a person, the person of Jesus Christ. And so as we pray this morning, let's really focus on the idea that we are bringing all our prayers before a person who loves us, who has loved us to death and has saved us through his sacrifice. So let's pray. Lord God, first of all, we want to give you thanks. We think of the prayers we've offered up to you in the past that have been answered. We think of your creation around us. We think of the gifts you've given us. We pray using the words of Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Jesus, Saviour, we trust in your power and goodness. And Lord Jesus, we come to ask you for forgiveness as well. Oh God, we bring to mind the times when we've acted as gods in our own lives. The times when we've not looked to you. The times when we've shied away from doing what is right and we've actively embraced what is wrong. Lord God, those things, those corners of our lives that we're too ashamed to even think about for too long ourselves. Bring them before you now, Lord, knowing that you are the God who loved us, who loves us to death. And we pray using the words of Psalm 32, verses 1-7. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me, my strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. And you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising of mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. Jesus, Saviour, we trust in your power and goodness. And lastly, Lord, we come before you to ask for your intervention in our lives, in the lives of people we care about. We bring before you our worries, our concerns. God, we bring before you Cynthia, who is hoping to be home soon after breaking her hip a couple of weeks ago. Oh God, we pray for Celia, who had a fall yesterday, and Stan. Pray for your presence with them. And we pray for the leavers service tomorrow for St. James Church School. We pray that all those who walk through this door as part of that service tomorrow will feel your presence. We know your peace in this place. And we pray using the words of Psalm 86, verses 1 to 13. Hear me, Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Guard my life, for I am faithful to you. Save your servant who trusts in you. You are my God, have mercy on me, Lord. For I call to you all day long. Bring joy to your servant, for I put my trust in you. You, Lord, are forgiving and good, abounding in love to all who call to you. Hear my prayer, Lord. Listen to my cry for mercy. When I am in distress, I call to you because you answer me. Among the gods, there is none like you, Lord. No deeds can compare with yours. All the nations you have made will come and worship before you. They will bring glory to your name, for you are great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God. Teach me your way, Lord, that I may rely on your faithfulness. Give me an undivided heart that I may fear your name. I will praise you, Lord my God, with all my heart. I will glorify your name forever, for great is your love towards me. You have delivered me from the depths, from the realm of the dead. Let me say together to finish. Lord Jesus Christ, full of the Spirit, hear us, receive our prayers, fill our lives. Amen.
I have two pair of glasses. This one I can still see you, the other one I can only see. So I said, which one do I need to take? Coming to a time when we have communion, so we have the words of peace. Shall we all stand? And that grace promise that we are justified by faith, and that gives us peace with God and brings that peace to one another. So since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. So the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
So let us share a sign of God's peace. If you're not used to, you might have someone coming and shaking your hands and says, peace, O Lord, with you. If you are able, do remain standing, but if you prefer sitting down, that's fine too. The words will come on screen. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Father, you made the world and love your creation, and you gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. His dying and rising has set us free from sin and death, and so we gladly thank you with saints and angels, praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Lord God, you are the most holy one, enthroned in splendor and light. Yet in the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ, you revealed the power of your love, made perfect in human weakness. Amen. Lord, we believe. Embracing our createdness, Jesus showed the way of salvation. Loving to the end, he gave himself to death for us and for all the world. Dying for all that he had made, he set us free from the bonds of sin and released creation from its bondage to decay. Amen, Amen Lord, we believe. On the night before he died, he took bread. He gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Amen. Lord, we believe. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Amen. Lord, we believe. Therefore, Father, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate the cross on which he died to set us free. Defying death, he rose again and is alive with you to plead for us and all the world. Amen. Lord, we believe. Look with favor on your people. And in your mercy, hear the cry of our hearts. Bless the earth. Heal the sick. Let the oppressed go free. And fill your church with power from on high. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Please be seated and join me in the Lord's Prayer. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. All are welcome to share the bread and the wine. There will be two stations and you'll be guided through. At the same time, there will be prayer ministry at the back. There is a flag there, a blue flag with a prayer hand and a few chairs. So if you want to receive prayer ministry, do so during communion. If I can ask those who are helping me to come forward, and we'll share communion first. So we're coming to the end of our service. Just a few notices, and then we'll have our final song. So just to, for those who are interested, the room is not really a service. It's a room, a space to worship God. So there's lots of singing and songs. You don't have to be singing. You can just relax and sit, a place to encounter God and to be refreshed, revived, and restored. That's at 7 o'clock in the main hall. And then there is a quiet day. Now, Felicity, are you ready to say something about it? Just for you, put that in your agenda. 23rd of September, it's going to be here in the church. It's going to be very exciting, but I know that you want to open to others with their ideas and their creativity, and they need to come to you. So if you can tell a little bit.
Yes, we feel this is very much a follow-on from our previous quiet day, and a follow-on from the month of prayer. And we will be holding a quiet day here on September the 23rd. It's a Saturday, and it's exploring and helping you to grow your prayer life, really. Lots of different traditional ways of praying that you may not have tried before. So we do encourage you to think about that, and you'd be very welcome.
Well, Felicity said most of it, but it's interactive, and for it to be interactive, we need some help to make it happen. So if you are called, and certainly people were called when we came first to the microphone, to share some art, sacred art that you might have, or poetry, it can be help us build a labyrinth. Do you know what a labyrinth is? Are you interested? We'd love to have one in the middle of the church. So really, it's very exciting. It's not for just for St. James. It will be open to everybody and anybody. Come for an hour or come for the day. But there'll be more.
Okay, thank you. So I think for today, if they come to you and have a chat with you, And if you're happy with that, maybe from next week we can put an email address, and so people then can drop that and then contact you like this. So exciting. And then I couldn't remember, is it heroes or is it giants? I think we choose heroes, huh? Yeah, heroes. I'm not wrong. You know, I'm dyslexic. I always forget. So heroes of faith. That's our next series starting from next Sunday. And it's going to be exciting for the whole family, the grown-ups and the little ones. And there will be St. James players helping. There will be activities for the children. But so throughout the summer, it's all age, all together. And we're going to look at some of those big heroes of faith. And just to let you know, we've decided to keep the quiet room, the quiet space, so it will remain open. It's holidays, so we might not be able to have all those hours, but we will try to have it open through the week, 9 to 5, and hopefully on Saturday. But at the moment, I've been opening, so we'll see. But it's there for you and for the community to be a place of prayer, encountering God, and just being quiet. So that's it. If I can ask the worship team to come, and we will finish with Hear the Call of the Kingdom. So shall we stand?
Christ to redeem all the trust in his unfading.
So let's say together, God of power, may the boldness of your spirit transform us. May the gentleness of your spirit lead us. And may the gifts of your spirit equip us to serve and worship you now and always. Amen. And filled with the Spirit's power, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Tea and coffee served at the back. Have a great Sunday and see you next week for Heroes of Faith.